Hi everyone, this is Victor here. Welcome to the Intelligent Investor channel. Several subscribers asked me to analyze Etsy stock to see if it's a great company for the long term. Etsy recently reported its Q2 earnings. The company's revenue and earnings beat Wall Street analysts' estimates, but the stock still dropped 14% in after-hours trading because Etsy's management gave a very light Q3 guidance, suggesting the company's revenue growth is much lower than before. This is why Etsy stock dropped 14% in after-hours trading. As an investor, you may ask, is Etsy a great stock for the long term? What is Etsy's long-term growth prospect after the pandemic is over? What are the risks? And what is Etsy's fair intrinsic value per share? To answer these questions, I will cover these topics in this video. First, I will talk about what is Etsy's business model. Then I will talk about is Etsy's growth decelerating as the economy reopens. After that, I will talk about what is Etsy's long-term growth prospect. I will also talk about what is Etsy's biggest risk. At the end, I will talk about what is Etsy's fair intrinsic value per share. I will also talk about what are the key takeaways. If you like this video, make sure to smash the like button, subscribe, and turn on the notification button. I will continue to make many excellent stock analysis and portfolio analysis videos every week that will help you become a great investor. Also, if you like this channel and want to support it, check out my Patreon blog in the video description and become a VIP patron. You'll be able to follow all the stocks I'm buying for the long term, and you'll be able to download the latest intrinsic value calculators I use to analyze stocks, so you will know when a stock is currently overvalued, fairly valued, or undervalued. The link is in the video description. Take a look. Let's start. What is Etsy's business model? Etsy is the most well-known e-commerce marketplace in the US that specializes in selling handmade, unique, and vintage items online. If you look at Etsy's website here, you can see all these handmade and vintage items ranging from clothing, accessories, household, toys, arts and collectibles, to craft supplies. Etsy's biggest competitive advantage is that you can often find very unique and handcrafted items you cannot normally find on other e-commerce platforms such as Amazon and eBay. Etsy runs a very light marketplace business model, meaning it does not buy its own inventory. It does not have inventory costs on its balance sheet. Instead, the seller owns the inventory. This is why Etsy is already a profitable business, even though Etsy is much smaller than Amazon and eBay. Also, Etsy has very small capital expenditures each quarter compared with its operating cash flow. This is why you can see Etsy already has consistent free cash flow each quarter here. Etsy earns revenues from two main sources, marketplace revenue and services revenue. Marketplace revenue consists of listing, transaction, and payment fees charged to sellers. Services revenue consists of advertising and shipping label fees charged to sellers. Now, according to the recent Q2 2021 quarter, marketplace revenue was 74.8% of total revenues. Services revenue was 25.2% of total revenues. In addition to Etsy's primary Etsy.com marketplace, it owns three other independent online marketplace platforms, Reverb, Depop, and Allo7. Reverb is an online marketplace that sells new, used, and vintage musical instruments. Etsy recently acquired Depop that focuses on the Generation Z market. Depop is an online marketplace that mainly sells second-hand clothes and accessories. Etsy also recently acquired Allo7. Allo7 is known as the Etsy of Brazil. Allo7 is an online marketplace that sells unique and handmade items in Brazil, Latin America. Now, both Depop and Allo7 acquisitions are not reflected on Etsy's balance sheet in Q2 yet, because both acquisitions were recently completed in Q3 this year. At the time of making this video, Etsy's standalone marketplace platform has 89.6 million active buyers, excluding Reverb and the recently acquired Depop and Allo7 platforms. Now let's talk about why Etsy's revenue growth is decelerating. Etsy benefited a lot from the pandemic in 2020. Etsy's revenue and gross merchandise sales, GMS, grew over 100% year over year almost every quarter in 2020. The stock increased as much as 296% in the same period in 2020. But in 2021, Etsy's recent revenue growth is much lower now than 2020 because stores are reopening. more people are vaccinated, and more people are shopping in offline brick and mortar stores again. So for example, if you look at Etsy's 2020 earnings here, you can see Etsy's gross merchandise sales, GMS, grew 106% year over year, and its revenue grew 111% year over year in 2020. In comparison, if you look at Etsy's recent Q2 2021 earnings slide here, you can see Etsy's GMS grew 13% year over year, and its revenue grew 23% year over year. To be fair, it's a tough comparison between Etsy's current growth rate with its 2020 growth rate, because the pandemic had forced everyone to shop online instead of going to offline retail stores in 2020. In terms of guidance, Etsy's management expects Etsy's consolidated GMS will grow 12.5% year over year at the midpoint in Q3 this year, and consolidated revenue will grow 13.5% year over year at the midpoint in Q3 this year. So is Etsy's GMS and revenue growth slowing? The short answer is yes, because more people are vaccinated and because more consumers are returning to shop in brick and mortar stores. This means we should not expect Etsy to have over 100% growth each quarter going forward. Realistically, we should expect Etsy's revenue and GMS growth to normalize and return to historical growth rates similar to the growth rates before the pandemic started. So what is Etsy's long-term growth prospect? As of now, Etsy's most important business is still its standalone Etsy.com marketplace because it contributes the most revenues, GMS, and net profit for the company. According to management, Etsy.com marketplace will continue to be the vast majority of our top and bottom line performance, at least in the near term. In the short term, we can expect Etsy's active buyer growth will either be flat or have a very low growth rate as the economy reopens. The main reason is that Etsy had already acquired a large number of new buyers in 2020, which would normally take Etsy years to acquire. This is what we call the pull forward effect. This is why you can see Etsy's active buyer growth have flattened in the recent Q2 2021 quarter compared with the previous Q1 quarter. In the long term, I believe Etsy's active buyers, GMS, and revenue will grow at a much lower rate than before. Etsy's international expansion should help Etsy continue its growth going forward, but again at a much lower rate than 2020. For example, Etsy's management said this about its Q3 expected growth rate. Within our Q3 GMS guidance, we are forecasting very solid growth for the Etsy.com standalone marketplace. We expect to deliver mid-single-digit GMS growth and growth in the mid-teens, excluding face masks. Outside of the US market, Etsy also operates in the United Kingdom, Germany, Canada, Denmark, France, Australia, and India. Etsy's management said the international market is once again growing at a faster rate than the US market in both gross merchandise sales GMS growth and active buyer growth, unlike in the US where we are seeing deceleration in new buyer growth. As of Q2 2021, 41% of total GMS came from the international market outside of the United States, up from 32% from the same period in 2020. Etsy recently acquired both Depop and Elo7 platforms, which are already completed in July this year. Etsy's management said this about Depop that is known for reselling secondhand clothing and accessories. We believe Depop is the best asset in the resale space, given its high user engagement metrics. The US secondhand market opportunity is projected to double to $77 billion by 2025, and the resale portion of secondhand is forecasted to grow 11 times faster than retail clothing for the next 5 years. We're also seeing that young consumers are adopting secondhand fashion faster than any other audience. And Depop is the 10th most visited shopping site among Generation Z consumers in the US. Etsy's management said this about Elo7, which is known as the Etsy of Brazil. Now turning to Elo7. Elo7 is known as the Etsy of Brazil, a leader in custom and made-to-order merchandise. We now have a foothold in Latin America, a region with high barriers to entry. Where we previously did not have a meaningful customer base, Elo7 is ranked as a top 10 e-commerce site in Brazil, providing us with a strong local brand in the largest Latin America e-commerce region. E-commerce in Latin America is estimated to be less than 10% penetrated and is expected to reach approximately $160 billion by 2025. Brazil alone is forecasted to reach $50 billion in the same period. Now, I mentioned this earlier, both Depop and LO7 are not consolidated with Etsy's financials yet at the time of making this video, so I would not know how they will affect Etsy's financials. But according to Etsy's Q3 guidance, Etsy's take rate is expected to drop from 17.7% to 17.4% after including Depop and LO7. And Etsy's adjusted EBITDA margin is expected to drop from 28% to 25% after including Depop and LO7 platforms. Personally, I believe we should be much more conservative in Etsy's growth rate going forward because Etsy's growth has slowed down significantly in the recent quarter. If I want to invest in Etsy's stock, I will watch out for Etsy's active buyer growth, GMS growth, and revenue growth each quarter going forward. Now, let's talk about the risk. I believe Etsy's biggest risk now is much lower revenue and GMS growth going forward. Management said, but in light of the expected Q2 headwinds, there has been steady deceleration as the world has reopened. Etsy's GMS and revenue grew over 100% almost every quarter in 2020. Now, in the recent Q2 2021 quarter, Etsy's total GMS, including mask sales, grew 10% year over year. And GMS, excluding mask sales, on Etsy's standalone marketplace grew 31% year over year. Its total revenue grew 23.4% year over year. Etsy's growth rate in 2020 was much larger also because of the enormous demand for face masks. Now the demand for handcrafted face masks is much lower, so we should expect Etsy to have much lower growth rates going forward. Similar to the first risk, I believe the second biggest risk is that Etsy should have very low active buyer growth going forward because of the pull forward effect I talked about earlier. If you look at this active buyer chart here, you can see Etsy's active buyers grew significantly between Q2 2020 and Q1 2021. This is because the pandemic in 2020 had forced consumers to shop online instead of going to brick and mortar stores. This pull forward effect has caused Etsy to grow its active buyers from 59.5 million in Q2 2020 to 89.7 million in Q1 2021, which would normally take Etsy several years to grow. But if you look at the growth from Q1 2021 to Q2 2021, you can see active buyers, repeat buyers, and habitual buyers were flat. This suggests Etsy's active buyer growth has slowed down by a lot. Etsy's management said this, given the massive pull forward in new buyer acquisition last year, it's no surprise that the new buyer growth has decelerated materially in recent months. However, that deceleration has been offset by the growth in GMS per active buyer, which as you know, is a big focus area for us. I believe Etsy's third risk is competition with other e-commerce platforms. Etsy's biggest competitors include Amazon Homemade Store, eBay, and Shopify. On the seller side, sellers can choose to list their handcrafted and vintage items on Amazon and eBay. Sellers can also create their own online stores using Shopify instead of using Etsy. So they can manage their brands better and own their customer list instead of letting Etsy own their customer list. On the buyer side, I believe Etsy's biggest competitive advantage is that buyers can often find many unique handmade and vintage items they cannot find on other e-commerce platforms. Now, as far as I know, many buyers who want to search for handmade and vintage items tend to use Etsy first before using other e-commerce platforms. Let's talk about Etsy's fair intrinsic value. First, I define Etsy's intrinsic value as its future cash flows discounted to the present day. We're using Etsy's free cash flow to estimate its fair intrinsic value since Etsy already has consistent free cash flows each quarter. I want to show you this intrinsic value calculator here. You can download it in my Patreon blog in the video description. Now, here are the key assumptions. We are using a discount rate of 8.1%. This is the cost of equity calculated by Finbox.com. I'm expecting Etsy's free cash flow will grow at a compound annual growth rate, CAGR between 10% and 20% over the next 5 years. I believe this estimate is reasonable. To calculate the terminal value, we're using both the perpetual growth model and the exit multiple model. Then I take the average of both models to calculate the terminal value at the end of year 5. Now let's go over these three case scenarios, the worst case, the normal case, and the best case scenarios. Under the worst case scenario, we're using a 10% compound annual growth rate. If we project Etsy's free cash flow to the next 5 years and then discount the free cash flows to the present day, then Etsy's intrinsic value for the whole company should be around 18.76 billion. And if we divide this by the shares outstanding, then Etsy's interest rate should be around $147.56 per share. Under the normal case scenario, we're using a 15% compound annual growth rate. If we project Etsy's free cash flow to the next 5 years, and then discount the free cash flows to the present day, then Etsy's interest rate should be around $23.05 billion. If we divide this by the shares outstanding, then Etsy's interest rate should be around $181.39 per share. Under the best case scenario, if we project Etsy's free cash flows to the next 5 years and then discount the free cash flows to the present day, then Etsy's interest rate for the whole company should be around $28.14 billion. And if we divide this by the shares outstanding, then Etsy's interest rate should be around $221.38 per share. Under the normal case scenario with a 15% compound annual growth rate, CAGR, I believe Etsy's fair intrinsic value is $23.05 billion for the whole company and $181.39 per share. This means Etsy is fairly valued or slightly undervalued at the time of making this video. So what are the key takeaways? First, we should not expect Etsy's revenue and GMS to have more than 100% growth each quarter going forward. Also, we should not expect Etsy stock to grow as much as 296% in 1 year. Realistically, I believe Etsy will have much lower active buyer growth, GMS growth, and revenue growth rates going forward. If Etsy's free cash flow grows at a 15% CAGR over the next 5 years, I believe its fair intrinsic value is $23.05 billion for the whole company or $181.39 per share. This means Etsy is likely fairly valued or slightly undervalued at the time of making this video. Personally, I don't have any positions in Etsy stock at the time of making this video. I prefer buying Amazon shares instead of Etsy. Now, all these are only my opinions and my analysis based on my research. They are not financial advice. I always say this, make sure you always do your research and do your extra due diligence first. If you like this video, make sure to smash the like button, subscribe, and turn on the notification button. I will continue to make many excellent stock analysis and portfolio analysis videos every week that will help you become a great investor. Also, if you like this channel and want to support it, check out my Patreon blog in the video description and become a VIP patron. You'll be able to follow all the stocks I'm buying for the long term, and you'll be able to download the latest intrinsic value calculators I use to analyze stocks, so you'll know when stock is currently overvalued, fairly valued, or undervalued. Thank you for watching this video. This is Victor from the Intelligent Investor channel, and I will see you in the next video.